Kristen introduced us to our scripture for this morning. We're going to look at chapter 15 of the Gospel of John, the first 8 verses. And this is Jesus talking. He's teaching his disciples. He says, "I am the true vine, and my Father is the gardener. He cuts off every branch in me that bears no fruit, while every branch that does bear fruit, he prunes so that it will be even more fruitful. You are already clean because of the word I have spoken to you. Remain in me, and I will remain in you. No branch can bear fruit by itself. It must remain in the vine. Neither can you bear fruit unless you remain in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. If a man remains in me and I in him, he will bear much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing. If anyone does not remain in me, he is like a branch that is thrown away and withers. Such branches are picked up, thrown into the fire, and burned. If you remain in me and my words remain in you, ask whatever you wish, and it will be given you. This is to my Father's glory, that you bear much fruit, showing yourselves to be my disciples." This is the word of God for us this morning. We are in a message series looking at the building blocks of our faith, and I invited our kids, or really anyone that wanted to build something for me, to show me their skills, their creativity with their Legos and things, and said for this Sunday they could do some patriotic things, but for other Sundays they could just do things that remind them of their faith. So I still invite you all to do that. I didn't get any this week other than my kids. I had them build this down here. I don't know if you can see it. It's kind of small. They were disappointed. There weren't many green Legos here at the church, but they built a Statue of Liberty for us there. I also went looking online to find some other monuments, and I have some pictures of ones I found. The White House, you can get a whole set to build your own White House out of Legos. The next one, kind of cool, Mount Rushmore. Someone took the time to put that all together and make it out of Legos. The next one is that Iwo Jima picture. You know, the guys, I thought that one was kind of cool. I wanted my kids to do that one, but that one's kind of tough to build that. So that one's neat. The next one is the Washington Monument. I like that one because it has the reflection of the building down in the pool below. So that took some creativity to do that one. It's kind of neat to see the monuments made out of Legos, but it's more neat, I think, to see them in person. You know, the real monument that's there. So I hope that you've seen some of these. The next picture I have is of a real monument. That's the Herndon Monument. Herndon. It's on the naval base in Annapolis, and there's a tradition around this monument. It's kind of shaped like the Washington Monument, but it's only 21 feet tall, which is still pretty tall. I mean, that's over twice the height of a basketball hoop. But there's a tradition that goes with this monument. Every year at the end of the school year, plebes, which are the first-year students at the Naval Academy, have to do a race to kind of get to the top. Not really a race, but it's a whole thing where they have to, the upperclassmen put a cap on the top of this monument, so 21 feet up, and then the plebes have to get up to the top, take that cap off, and put on the cap of an upperclassman. It's kind of that transition time to show that they have learned about perseverance and all these kind of things, and they're ready to go on to the next part of their school year. And so I couldn't find out how long they've been doing this, but they have times they've kept of each class since 1959, I think was the first time they started keeping record of the amount of time it takes them to get to the top. And they time it because it's more than just getting to the top. When the upperclassmen put the cap on the top, they also grease the monument. They put Crisco or whatever on it in order to make it all slippery so that it's not as easy to get up there to the top. And I'm going to show you a video from this past week. It's actually from Monday, of the most recent class trying to get the cap off the top. And you'll notice the guys all have their shirts off, and I think they take their shirts off to then wipe the grease off of the monument to make it easier. So that's one of the things they have learned to do to get there. So let's see how this most recent class did. So that was Monday. They were doing that, getting that up there. And doesn't that look kind of crazy, kind of painful, falling down on those people? And but yet they were working together, holding each other up and getting up there. You notice they said the longest time was 4 hours. It took one class. And that was because the upperclassmen glued and taped the first cap on the top. So they had to get up there and rip it off of there. So, but they did pretty good. Best time in 40 years, this class did. I thought that was a very realistic picture of what life is like. And our faith journey. A lot of times I think, I look at our faith journey, I feel like it's we picture it as a journey of one. That it's just me walking along, it's me and my journey in life. And maybe it's me and Jesus, maybe it's a journey of two, but I think that real life is much more like that. It's much more of a mass of chaos, it's much more of us holding one another together, lifting each other up. It's much more of a team effort than a lot of times we think about. And as I was thinking of our building blocks of faith, I started thinking about, well, what's a building block of my faith? And I started, like many of us do, we start to look at ourselves. What's important to me in my life? And I kind of started, as I was reflecting, recognize one of the building blocks of our faith is community. It's community. It's realizing that my faith journey, my faith, my life is not just about me. It's not about me. It's not about you. But it's about God. And it's about God holding us together in community as we go through life together. And so I want us to think this morning about this building block of community, of being with one another, holding each other up, and how important and significant that is for each of us to go through life together with one another and not going it all on our own. And so we need to recognize that it's in community that we gather together. I often point out in the Ten Commandments, you know, God gives the Ten Commandments in the Old Testament, that four of them are about instructions on how we relate to God, but six of them are on how we relate to one another. So six of them, most of them, are about how we relate to community, to one another. And Jesus sums up those Ten Commandments in two commandments, right? He says, love God, love others. Again, it's not just about me. It's about loving God, and it's about loving others. There's community. And so we can't just focus on ourselves. If we focus on ourselves and just our faith journey, we're missing a major piece of the building blocks of our faith. And Jesus shows us a picture of what this looks like in this 15th chapter of John's gospel. And kind of his image for us is that he is the vine, we are the branches. And as Kristen was pointing out, we need to be connected to the vine, connected to the trunk, connected to the main body of Christ, of God. And that's where we get our fruitfulness. That's where we get our life from, is that connection. But as we connect with God in the middle, he connects us with everybody else. He reminds us it's about community. And to be fruitful in life and be fruitful in our faith, we must be connected to Christ and connected to all those who are around us. As I was thinking about this climb that they were doing, I was thinking if a plebe, you know, those first-year students, if they thought ahead a little bit on the first day of school, wouldn't it be cool if they planted a vine at the bottom of that monument? Now, probably the upperclassmen would rip it out or something, but I thought about what if on the first day of school they planted a vine? Because vines are good at climbing, aren't they? They climb up the wall. I have a picture of just vines that climb up the wall. That's what they do. And so what if they planted a vine at the bottom of that monument, and for the 9 months that they're in school, they watered it, they fertilized it, they cared for it, they helped it to grow. Maybe by the end of school, they'd have a vine up there. They could just use that to get up to the top, not that they wouldn't rip it out. But, you know, it was, as I was thinking of that, I was reminded that community doesn't just happen, does it? Community takes time. It takes nurturing. It takes work. Community doesn't just happen where we just show up and all of a sudden, now I think I know everybody. It takes time for us to get to know one another, to find out things about each other. And so community, just like a vine, takes time to nurture and to grow. Just because we see somebody here maybe at church every Sunday that we're here doesn't mean that we know them, does it? We might know their name, but we will have to actually talk to them and get past the how are you, I'm fine surface conversations and actually get to know one another. In order to really build community, we have to be willing to open ourselves up to that conversation, open ourselves up and share who we are, and then be willing to connect with those that are around us. And I think it'd be kind of fun to have some master gardeners in our church, some people who maybe were assigned to create community among us. You know, maybe they plan dinner parties or they plan excursions, opportunities for us to get together. And I think we do that in other places as we serve, as we're in small groups, we have those opportunities, but it'd be fun to have some other ones. Not that I want us to become like a social club where we just, you know, have fun together, but we need that social interaction with each other to build community. We need to start to get to know each other's names and grow that connection that we have with with one another. And I'll be first to admit, I'm not great at that stuff. As an introvert, I don't always think of how to connect with people and how to do things. A couple weeks ago, I needed some help with some yard work here at the church to get ready for the building project. So I sent an email out to like 20 guys and just trying to get six of them. We had eight of them come. Eight of us were here together. And we got to work. We started doing all this stuff. And we were almost done with the work. And I finally realized, we never introduced ourselves. These guys may not know who is there working with them. And so finally we stopped and I introduced each of them. And as soon as they knew each other's names, they started saying, oh, are you related to so-and-so? And they started making connections because we took the time to share names, to connect in community and to be strengthened in one another. And so it's important for all of us as we are building our faith to remember it's not about me. It's not about you. It's about community, about connecting to Christ and connecting to one another. And so that's something that we need to all be working on in order to grow and to care for each other. I was thinking it's a lot easier to care for someone that you know than someone that you don't know, right? If you don't know somebody, but you hear maybe that they lost their job, it's hard to go and console them if you don't know them real personally, isn't it? Even congratulating someone on good things, if you don't know them, that's difficult. We went to the teacher's retirement thing this last week for the elementary school teachers. There were four of them. Pam's here. I didn't know if I saw Deb in here. Two of them are from our church. And so we're like, well, we want to go and congratulate them on their retirement and wish them well and those kind of things. So we go, and then there's two other retirees that we don't really know. And it's kind of awkward because you're like, well, there's only four of them. I probably should go say something, you know. But I don't know. One of them, I don't even know her name. The other one, I knew her name. But it was kind of just, it's like, oh, man, even to congratulate someone's awkward if you're not connected in community, right? And as a church, we need to be connecting to one another and connecting to people around our community. We need to be growing a community garden where we have these relationships as we get to know each other so that we can be there for each other in those great times, but also in difficult times. A great example, I think, for us to think about as we want to connect with one another is the redwood trees out in California. Have any of you seen those redwood trees, like in person? A few of you have seen them out there. They're just huge. They're like 300 feet tall, the largest living plants in the world. 300 feet tall, that's a football field straight up. That's how tall they are. And they can be 18 to 20 feet around at the trunk. Just these huge things. And you would think for something to be that tall and to stay up, the roots are going to go down deep, right? Right, Kristen? They're going to go down deep, and they're going to be this huge mass of roots underneath. That's not the way the redwoods work. Their roots only go down about 10 feet, is what I read. And what happens is those roots, instead of going down, they go out under the ground. And so the next slide shows that they start to grab a hold of the roots of the other trees. And so they start to interlock their roots. And so what happens is not that they're going down deep, but they're reaching out wide and they're holding each other up. One website said it's like they hold hands underground. And so when the storms blow, the trees don't fall over because they're holding each other up. And I thought, isn't that what our community is supposed to be like? Aren't we supposed to be holding each other's hands, even if it's under the ground, but we need to be holding each other's hands so that when those storms come, we can hold each other up. And that's not going to happen if we don't have community. It's not going to happen if we don't get to know one another, if we don't spend time with each other, if we don't open ourselves up first to be known by others around us. And so I want to encourage and challenge you to begin to hold hands with people around you, which means share your name, share who you are, share what's important to you with other people, and then invite them, ask them to share those things with you. I think that as a congregation, on Sunday mornings especially, we're getting to a place where people could sneak in here and out without talking to anybody. I'm sure we've had it happen. People come in and leave without talking to a single person, even though there's hundreds of people around them, probably because they kind of want to hide, but they could do that. And I don't want that to happen. I want anyone that comes here to know that they're known, that they're welcome, that they're a part of community. And so we need to be aware to be reaching out, to hold hands, to connect with other people, and to let them know that they're welcome to come and be here. We had a person that hadn't been to our church for quite a while come, I think it was maybe just last Sunday even, they were here, and I was like, oh, I always want those people to connect, you know, find someone they know, do this and that, but I was distracted by things and didn't get a chance to, but I heard later from Helen that another couple said, hey, come sit with us when they saw that person come in. Come sit with us, and they sat with them and found out that they knew each other from work, but they were building that connection by saying, hey, sit with us. Be with us. You belong here. And that's what we need to continue to be working on. we're working on creating those kind of opportunities to get to know each other. One thing we're working on is trying to get greeters going again in the church, so that every Sunday when someone comes in, there's someone specifically there to say, welcome, glad to have you. Come on in. If you need help, let me know. So if anyone here wants to be a greeter, it's a great opportunity to get to know people, to get to know some new names and just welcome people. Let me know if you're interested in doing that. We'll put you get you connected. Or ushering is another great way. Ushers, we always need ushers on Sunday morning for the different services. Great opportunity to say hi to people as they come in. But find those places where you can connect and build that community, because that is a building block of our faith, is community. Our faith is not just about you. It's not just about me. It's about connecting to Christ and connecting to one another to build community, because he is the vine and we are the branches. Let us pray. Gracious God, we thank you that you call us to connect. You don't call us to go through this life alone, but you call us to reach out and hold hands with one another. Whether we physically do that, Lord, or whether we do that through connections as we get to know one another, we ask that you would strengthen those bonds, so that we can hold each other up, that we can work together for a common cause of making disciples of Jesus Christ for the transformation of the world. Continue to work in us, Lord, and build and strengthen this community garden, this community that we have here. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen.